Hi everyone, Omar is here. Today we're building an AM5 PC powered by the Ryzen 9 9900X. And the very first thing we're testing is whether it can run Windows 98, which is kind of an old friend on this channel. You might remember it ran like a champ on a socket 1700 system with a 14 gen CPU. So we know for sure that Windows 98 can handle very high clock speeds and DDR5 motherboards. But this is my first time trying it on AM5 hardware. We're not going over the installation steps again. There's nothing new to add here. I've already made at least 5 videos on that topic, maybe more if we count Windows ME. Today is all about putting the parts together and seeing how it all ends. I usually don't ask for hardware, but this time I took the Hollywood approach. You know what they say, never make a movie with your own money, or at least try to get some support. So I pitched the project to a few tech companies and asked for parts to build my retro modern AM5 PC. Now imagine you're one of those companies and you get an email that basically says, would you send me your latest gear so I can try running Windows 98 on it? Wait, what? Windows 98? And you need 64 gigabytes of DDR5 for that? Yeah, sounds like a long shot, right? But to my surprise, some brands love the idea. The first to jump in was Kingston, who sent over a 2 terabytes Fury Renegade Gen5 NVMe SSD and 64 gigabytes of DDR5 RGB RAM. Also from their Renegade series, which is their high-end lineup. Next, StarTech joined the party. They sent me a PCIe-to-PCI adapter, which is nice to have, of course, but they also sent me the best thing you could wish for in a build like this, a PCI Express-to-PCI enclosure. The idea is simple. We use one PCIe slot, a cable, and this enclosure, which has its own PCIe to PCI bridge, so we can simply add up to 4 PCI slots to the system. I love this thing and I've promised to make a separate video about it, so we'll see it in action next time. Take a closer look, go over the chips and check compatibility. And guess who else joined the party? The team at Arctic. Their response was fantastic. Your project sounds really exciting and you can count on us for cooling. I had asked for their liquid freezer 420 Pro AIO, but they also sent me their freezer 36 A-RGB cooler, plus a bunch of other stuff in March. So what can I say, they're truly a cool brand. Now it's actually a good thing that I have the freezer 36 cooler, because the case that can fit the liquid freezer 420 Pro still hasn't arrived. I was waiting and hoping for a case manufacturer to join the project, but that was a lost cause. I sent out a bunch of emails, but the replies were, well, non-existent. The one reply I got was something like, "We love your work, well, get in touch when we launch new models." So I ended up just ordering some interesting big case that can handle even a 480 AIO, and for now I'll be using my open air ATX case frame, which is actually the right thing for the testing phase anyway. Alright, now back to our configuration. When I started hunting for an AM5 motherboard for this project, it didn't take long to find the perfect match. My wishlist: high-end with APS support and at least 4 PCIe slots. That's how I found the ASUS Crosshair X870-E Apex. And wow, it has everything, including a second PCIe 5.0 X16 slot, something you don't see on most motherboards. And yes, it has even APS support, which is a must-have for the retro side of this build. But then I saw the price, $750. And with taxes, closer to 900. Since it's literally the only X870 motherboard with APS support, I had to look at another chipset. So I went with something not so fancy like the ASUS X670 Prime. It still gives me 4 PCIe slots, 3 M.2 slots, with one at PCIe 5.0 speed, and APS support, of course. all for just $200. Alright, let's put this thing together. The CPU is a Ryzen 9 9900X, and it was a open box return, about $50 cheaper, so I said, why not? I also have a 3900X, and this is going to be a big upgrade. The increased base clock and the newer Zen 5 architecture makes it something like 70, maybe 80% better in a single core performance. Both 3900X and 9900X launched at $499, but the 3900X originally shipped in a premium sleek sturdy box plus a big RGB red prism cooler. The 9900X just a plain box and a sticker. Now when it comes to cooling, I think we're covered. The freezer 36 with dual 120mm fans should handle a 120 watts chip like the 9900X just fine. And if we go with the big liquid freezer 420 Pro AIO, then we even have some headroom for overclocking. As usual, the radiator is secured with two spring-loaded screws, nothing fancy here, but when it comes to the 120mm A-RGB coolers, there are no more clumsy fan clips. Instead, you get a simple click system and the fans just attach to the radiator and stay firmly in place. The A-RGB fans have the logo on the front, of course, but since we'll be mounting one to push air and the other to pull it, Arctic includes a round sticker for the back of the fan hub. That way, the logo's visible from both sides. Now let's finish our setup. The manual says to mount the CPU first, which you kinda have to do, because if you install the cooler brackets first, they'll block the CPU lever. Then it suggests starting with the RAM and moving on to the NVMe. That exact order doesn't really matter, but let's go with RAM first. We've got two 32GB sticks running at 6400 MTs per second, which stands for mega transfers per second. That gives us exactly 51.2GB per second of bandwidth per module. And since we're running in dual channel, that's a total of 102.4GB per second. Now that's what I call fast. Latency is also solid. These are CL32 modules, and yes, they work as advertised on this motherboard. Even though they don't have AMD Expo tuned timings, the board simply reads the Intel XMP profile, and it's been completely plug and play so far. I haven't done any thorough testing yet, but things are looking good. Now let's finish our setup with the Kingston Renegade 2TB PCIe Gen 5 NVMe SSD. This tiny beast can hit transfer speeds over 14GB per second on a PCIe 5.0, and spoiler alert, it gets very close to the numbers printed on the box. The motherboard comes with a decent heatsink for the PCIe 5.0 M.2 slot, which makes sense. At these speeds, drives get really hot. There's also a slightly adhesive thermal pad for better heat transfer. But once it's on, the drive and heatsink are basically glued together. And since the heatsink also covers the M.2 release lever, well, let's just say it's not quite what I had in mind when I installed it. Now let's really finish the setup. The X670 chipset doesn't come with Zen 5 support, so this Ryzen 9 9900X needs a BIOS update. The good news, this board has a BIOS flashback button, a feature you really want, because it lets you update the BIOS while the system is powered off, but still getting a standby power from the PSU. No CPU or RAM is needed, it's all done in-house by the motherboard. To get the job done, you'll need a USB stick with a BIOS file on it. On the EOS shield, look for the USB port labeled BIOS and plug in your stick. Once it's in, press and hold the flashback button until it starts blinking. From that moment, just let it do its thing until the blinking stops. It can take a while, so I used an old USB stick with an activity LED. That way, I got double confirmation the update was actually running. So yeah, the BIOS flashback button saved the day. The system started just fine after the update. So I routed the video signal through my capture card and I couldn't wait to check Windows 98 compatibility. So that was the next thing on my list. Then came the extras. For Windows 98, you really need a dedicated sound card, since the HD audio that come with modern motherboards is just out of its league. Same with USB, you need a native USB 2/1.1 controller, since there are no official or unofficial drivers for USB 3. I went with a StarTech PCIe X1 adapter with a VIA6212 chip. I've shown this card before, it simply gets the job done. Finally, I added a Quadro FX 4500, basically a GeForce 7800 GTX in disguise. The cool thing about this card is that it also works in Windows NT 4.0, which is definitely on my list. With all the legacy hardware in place, I also added a more powerful GPU in the last PCIe X16 slot. The final build, some brand new RTX card should go there. And for Windows 11, it doesn't matter if the BIOS reports it as primary or not. However, for Windows 98, what the BIOS reports as the primary video card is very important, because there is no official or unofficial way to change that. That's why I tested if the board would boot with the Nvidia Quadro in the first X16 slot, since whatever card we put there becomes the primary video card. Next, I grabbed an SSD with Windows 98 already installed. If it's going to work, we should immediately see that classic new hardware found message, and we'll need to install all the hardware again. If not, we'll run into a critical error, usually the same one that shows up during a fresh install in the second part of the setup. The good news, the system did start with the Quadro GPU, which was kind of expected. The bad news, Windows 98 immediately hit me with an NTKERN Windows protection error. I'd never seen this one before on modern hardware, and I thought I knew all the errors by now. Next, I swapped the Windows 98 SSD with one that had Windows Millennium on it. I got the same error, just with a blue screen this time. Then I tried my Windows 3.1 setup, the one that runs in full HD, and it didn't boot either. Not exactly what I had in mind when I started picking parts for this AM5 build. Then I tried a Windows XP X64 installation, the one with the patched ACPI that I showed you recently. And surprise, no more errors, this time it actually worked. XP detects 24 CPUs, 64 GB of RAM, and even USB 3X and NVMe seem to work properly. This is going to be fun, but I hadn't given up on Windows 98 by any means. So I looked up the NTKERN error online, and it looked like it's speed related, similar to how Windows 95 can be sensitive to fast CPUs. With a base clock of 4.4 GHz, that made sense. So I started tweaking in the BIOS, lowering the clock, disabling virtualization, changing a lot of settings, but nothing helped. Then I thought, wait, Windows 3.1 couldn't boot from SATA either, even with ACPI fix 386 installed. That's a smaller real-mode driver that fixes certain issues when the onboard ACPI interface is running in legacy mode. Wasn't meant to be universal, but it works on a lot of motherboards, even on modern socket 1700 models. Before this patch existed, I used to boot Windows 3.1 using a PCI to SATA adapter, so I figured why not try that card again. This one even comes with its own BIOS, so whatever's wrong with the ACPI implementation, it's completely bypassed when using this adapter. This time I connected it through the PCIe to PCI adapter that StarTech sent me. We'll take a closer look in another video, but first impressions are good. It's got a smart rear bracket design that allows a low profile card to become one with the adapter. And the best part, it uses a Pericom bridge chip, which is more advanced than the ASMedia 1083 chip, which is the most common bridge chip you'll find on a PCIe to PCI adapters. And what do you know? As soon as I booted the system from the PCI to SATA card, I went straight into found the new hardware mode, and yes, Windows 98 does work on the AM5 platform and Gen5 CPUs. Next question, is Windows 98 stable on AM5? Yes, it is, if we install it without ACPI. So I ran a couple of 3D Mark tests and I got a decent result with a 7900GS card, close to the score I got on the 14th gen configuration with an i5-14600KF, where this very card scored 55k points. I mean, 56.2k points isn't bad at all for a 7900GS, but on this Ryzen 9900X, I was expecting a bit more, considering the higher base CPU clock. I also tested a PCIe-ATI-X700LE card. This is a 2004 first generation PCI Express GPU, and it worked on the first try. I couldn't get this card to boot with the ASUS Z790 motherboard, but on this setup, the LE model, which is the lowest in the lineup, performed more like a Pro or even an XT card. Usually it scores around 15k. In the end, I think we can officially say that Windows 98, AM5 and Zen5 CPUs are a thing. Windows 98 still doesn't boot from SATA, but I tested it on the Gen5 NVMe SSD from Kingston, and yes, it works. The secret, you just have to create a partition no larger than 8.5 gigabytes, as I've already shown in a previous video, that was on a Gen3 NVMe, but having a Gen5 model doesn't seem to change anything. Anyway, there are some resource conflict issues I didn't encounter at all on Intel hardware. For example, it wasn't easy to get my sound card recognized, which usually isn't a problem on other configurations. It was the first time I actually had to fiddle around to get sound. Weirdly enough, it worked better with a PCI sound card using the PCIe-to-PCI enclosure from StarTech, which doesn't really make much sense, so I'm still working to understand what's going on, and I'll make a follow-up video soon. Now, if Windows 98 isn't your thing, this is actually the pilot episode on something we are calling Every Windows on Zen 5, where we'll showcase basically every other version of Windows running on this hardware, and probably there will be some new additions too. Thanks for watching. Amores out.